the women's 200 metres qualifications, and during the session we've got four finals on the track: the women's 100 hurdles, the men's 1500. In the field, you've just seen some of the qualifiers that will appear for the women's long jump. There's a qualifying, two qualifying rounds, or two A and B qualifying pools in the women's long jump, and we've got the final of the men's discus and the final of the men's high jump. So there's quite a lot to look forward to here. And only one big casualty in the morning. Liu Zhang in the high hurdles didn't make it beyond the first hurdle, but apart from that, all was well, and all who should have qualified. So the early part of the program, we've got a victory ceremony for the 3000 meter steeplechase, I'm told, and then the women's long jump qualifying, the 100 meter hurdle semis then follow that. So there's an awful lot on this afternoon in the field, in particular. Alongside me, Peter Matthews, John Troer, first of all. John, a lot on in the field.
Well, we've got the high jump final for men, Stuart, and that's going to be a particularly close contest, I think. We had qualifying, the automatic qualifier was 2:32, but actually that wasn't needed because predominantly they cleared 2:29, and then we had four competitors qualify at 2:26. We've got a field of 14 for that, which is slightly unusual. And then we've got the long jump qualifying going on. That looks very, very busy over there. Lots of athletes preparing to compete in that. And then later on this evening, we have the final of the men's discus, which is going to be a fantastic affair because we've got sort of the old meeting the young in that. We've got Alekna, who's 40, for example, competing against one or two others, particularly Akui from Britain, who's 20, half his age, and they'll be slugging it out later.
Peter, your thoughts on the afternoon or the evening local time?
Well, of course, we're going to end up with the two finals, the women's sprint hurdles, and from what we saw in the heats this morning, Sally Pearson of Australia, who was in majestic form last year in Daegu to win the world title, looked very sharp indeed, and indeed easily the fastest qualifying time. But of course, there'll be some good competition, not least from the Americans, headed by Kelly Wells. And we've also got the 1500 meters. Quite an interesting race that, I think, particularly because we've got three Kenyans in the lineup, but there is a question mark over the fitness of the world number one of the last couple of years. That's Aspel Kiprop, and Nick Willis of New Zealand also threatening hard to challenge the might of the Kenyans in that. Before then, we've got the men's 800 meter semi-finals and the women's 200 meter semi-finals as well.
But first of all, we have the ceremony for the 3000 meter steeplechase.
Well, this was a race held last night, and the athlete in the center of that really did win it in style. Ran a terrific race, a terrific front-running race. We don't so often see an athlete leading all the way to win a distance race, but that is exactly what Yulia Zaripova of Russia did. She went to the front, she maintained a fairly slow pace, but then gradually increased the tempo, and it was a magnificent victory. And the slightly surprising thing is that Milka Chimos of Kenya isn't among the medals, but let's introduce the athletes who are. We have the medals presented here by Mr. Patrick Chamumba of Zambia, a member of the IOC. And he's accompanied the flower presenter, Mr. Jose Maria Odriozola, the IF Council member. Sophia Assefa of Ethiopia took the bronze medal. This wasn't one of those very close races. The three medalists, in fact, were very spaced out at the finish, but it was a fascinating one for all that. And good tactics, not slow tactics on this occasion, but fast front-running tactics. And the gold and silver, in fact, was identical to what happened in the World Championships last year, because to step up to receive the silver medal, just as she did in Daegu, is Habiba Gribi of Tunisia. National record for Garibi in second place. And the gold medalist, she's at a personal best. As I said, she ran right the way from the front and really streamed away from the field in the last lap. This is Yulia Zaripova of Russia. So the national anthem for the winner of the steeplechase, Zaripova. I wonder if we'll have another Russian winner this evening. Every chance, I think, in the high jump, where they have a very strong trio. But it's Zaripova, Garibi, and Asefa. And there's the big men, the discus throwers, getting ready.
Yeah, that's Mr. Harting. He looks pretty cool, doesn't he? Just moving slowly through that final call room. Mr. Lechner looking like he might be 40 years old. Mind the runner on the inside, Virgilius.
So we start the evening with the men's high jump.
Yeah, and what a great field we have got for this men's high jump. The Olympic record goes back to 1996 with Charles Austin. 2 meters 39, and the British athlete in this tonight, Grabas, who's the last to jump, but here's the starting order. But that can get shuffled around a little bit because the opening height is going to be 2 meters 20, and some of these guys will choose not to take that height, and therefore we'll just have to wait to see what the scorecard looks like once it actually starts in a few minutes' time. But if Grabar starts to go over the height, I think the crowd is going to be pretty excitable.
Sure it will. All but one of the competitors in there have bests at 2 metres 30 plus. The one is Miller, in fact, of Colombia. They're about to be introduced, all lining up on the high jump fan. And they've got to be prepared for a shower or two, perhaps, this evening.
Yeah, which won't help. So we got Protsenko from Ukraine. And then we have Bondarenko, also from Ukraine. These starting orders are drawn randomly. It's just strange that they should just come out with the two Ukrainians first up on the list. Then we have Bashim from Qatar. He has a best of 2:33 this year. And then Ioannou of Cyprus. One of the older men in the competition at 28. Then we have the defending Olympic champion, Andrei Sunov of Russia.
27-year-old with 2:37 in 2012 and a personal best of 2:38. Eric Kinnard of the United States, 21-year-old. Then we have Ivan Yukov of Russia. He's got a personal best of 2:39 and he jumped that in 2012. Jesse Williams from the United States. He's the 2011 world champion. Still a few more to go. Jamie Neto of the United States, one of the outer statesmen in the competition at 35 years of age, fourth in 2004 in Athens. Then we have Derek Druin from Canada, Juana Miller of Colombia, Michael Mason of Canada. He was the 2004 World Junior Champion. He's jumped 2:31 in 2012. 13th in the list is Mikhail Hanani of France. And last to jump will be Robbie Grabars of Great Britain, the 24-year-old who has improved immensely this year and is Britain's first European high jump champion outdoors since 1950. He won that in Barcelona just a couple of months ago. So 2.36 meters he's jumped this year, and he's well ranked in the world.
Meanwhile, the 100 meter hurdlers, we've got the American Dawn Harper. And
yeah, I was watching a little earlier and she's had a bandaged foot. Now, whether there is an injury there, I don't know, but she's certainly bandaged up. I think it was her right foot. And it's quite heavily bandaged, not her ankle, her foot. And that was extraordinary, just watching that. The sock went over it, so we're not quite sure what condition she's in. But we shall soon see, of course. Dawn Harper is in the first heat, which is scheduled to begin in about 15 minutes' time.
And we have another sellout crowd, I think, guys, because I can't see any spare seats around the stadium as I'm looking around. And we've also got a slight wind. So the wind report for this evening's session is that there is a sort of a slight wind of the flags at the opposite end to the high jump. It's not strong enough to put the flame up. That keeps burning, which is brilliant. But there is probably a little bit of circling wind down with the high jumpers. And as Peter indicated, the problem may be that we get some rain tonight. It's pretty grey.
And that, of course, will affect those that have the faster approaches and turn very quickly at the end of their run.
So it's Prochenko. He's coming in at 2:20, the opening height in this high jump. It will go up in 5 centimeters to 2:25, and then 4 centimeters after that until we hit 2:33, and then it will progress by 3 centimeters. So that's the plan. That's the overall plan. And Prochenko goes well clear on his first attempt. So that'll help to settle the nerves a little bit. And Bondarenko looks as though he's going to be the next up, the second Ukrainian in this final of the men's high jump. You can see those high jump shoes that Stuart alluded to earlier. They're specially constructed to support particularly the takeoff foot, because as you come in off the bend using this back over first technique, and we have our first failure. So Bondarenko will have to just settle himself down. Comes in steeply here, running, looks a bit ungainly, takes off a long way away from the bed. And he needs to get a little closer, I think. So
yeah,
it's high point.
Yeah, absolutely right. I think that the approach in high jump is absolutely vital. It is in all the jumps, of course, but particularly in this one, you have to be in the right place at the right time. And, there is a sense of awareness that you know that's right. And if you don't, then, all sorts can happen. But one or two choosing to go at an early height, aren't they? Barshim, I think he was seventh in the World Championships last year. He's only a youngster.
Yeah, he's a world junior champion in 2010, and he easily clears that his first attempt. So the youngster, who's just 21 years of age, has jumped 2:33 this year. 2:35 he jumped in 2011, and again looks a long way away from the bar, but has enough speed coming into the bar to get him over that, and it's a very nice clearance. So again, he'll be an interesting contender as we start to go to the heights that start to find them out.
I think it is raining at the moment, just looking out there.
So first up for his first attempt at 220 is Ayanu from Cyprus. And he goes clear too. And he almost looks as if he comes out of the blocks at the start of his run-up, doesn't he? And then just eases into a longer stride, gets into a nice takeoff position, converts that sort of horizontal speed into the vertical, and clears it very nicely.
Yeah, some will go very, very wide into the approach for this, and some will go almost straight into the bar and a very quick turn and a very hard hit on the deck and driving that inside knee upwards and keeping the shoulder, which is nearest the bar, high, because once it drops, then the whole thing fails.
So here we have the defending Olympic champion, Silnov from Russia. And that was very casual and very nice, and he goes clear and he gets a circle. Of course, you come in at this height, and we can see Silnov coming in here, gets nice, didn't seem to be turning up the noise too much on the speed as he came in. But of course, clearances are really important at these lower heights, because when you come to check the result at the end, they'll check back and see who's knocked it down. And that, like it did in the pole vault last night, can have serious consequences for winning medals. So count back is a very important factor in this event. Eric Kinnard from America, he takes his first attempt at 2 meters 20, and that's a good clearance by Kinnard. They're certainly rattling through these. Only one failure so far, that was Bondarenko from Ukraine, but a good clearance by the American.
I just have a feeling that they may be expecting rain and they're trying to get a jump in quick.
And Yukov from Russia. And again, he goes clear.
It's just sprinkling with rain and then it's stopped. It's just intermittent at the moment, so nothing really noticeable. Looking across there, I did, with the binoculars, saw the rain just for a moment.
Now he goes clear comfortably in that, and he has a penchant for jumping well indoors. So it'll be interesting to see if it does rain, whether he's one of the first ones to suffer. Next up will be Jesse Williams from the United States. He's got a personal best of 2 meters 37, but he's cleared 2.36 in 2012. And he's got springs in his heels, hasn't he? Because that was a really comfortable clearance. And again, these early heights, it's good just to test the run-up out. And as Stuart's intimated, if it starts to rain, they need to get a clearance. And he slipped on the bed there, so there is a bit of rain about. And that'll just make things a little bit challenging if it continues to rain. So Williams goes clear. And the next to jump will be Jamie Neato. There are three Americans in this competition tonight. So Neato was fourth in Athens in 2004, so he's been close before to the medal hunt, Neato of United States. Well, he seemed to stutter a little bit coming in as he made the curve in. Just there, stuck a couple of short strides in. That'll be an interesting development as the bar goes up high, because you need to be progressively accelerating into that takeoff point. So he gets a circle for 2 meters 20. And the next to jump will be Derek Druin of Canada. 2.33 PB, but personal best, and 2.31 in 2012. So Druin of Canada, his first attempt at 2 meters 20. And again, we get a clearance. We've only had one athlete knock the bar down so far. That was Bondarenko on his first attempt. That's Druin comfortably over the opening height of 2 meters 20. And you can see the men for the discus final coming out from the bowels of the stadium. We saw them warming up earlier in that about 80 meters long, six-lane track underneath the stadium. And the discus men are looking up. They're looking up at the sky. They don't like the wet either, so they'll be hoping that the rain stays away. Makes that circle just a little bit too quick for some of them. So that's Robert Harting striding purposely into the stadium.
Well, we've also got the women's long jump qualifying, and the crowd have been aroused to the fact that the new British record holder, Shara Proctor, who originally came from Anguilla, is about to take her first jump. Now, the qualifying standard is 6 metres 70. And that's a terrific start there, way over that green line showing the qualifying standard. Slight headwind, 0.3 metres per second there. So a superb start by Proctor, who will go straight into qualifying for the final. Hits the board perfectly. Everything was right about this jump. Good speed, good spring, and a very fine jump indeed from the athlete who's been setting British records first indoors. Got a world indoor medal, and now 6 metres 83.
Looking down at the high jump from a distance, it looks like that the bar has been put back up, and here we go to Harnenet on France, his first attempt at 2 meters 20, and he's just clipped that with his heels. So it looks like we're going to have two athletes that have failed the opening height.
Just one athlete passing.
Well, I'm just looking at the score sheet, and Robbie Grabas from Great Britain has indicated that he's not going to be taking this as his opening height. So perhaps that indicates a bit of confidence in the British camp. We'll have to see as that materialises and starts to develop. But at this moment in time, we've got two jumpers who've got to come back and have their second attempts at 2 metres 20.
Well, crowd getting ready for rain.
So Bondarenko for his second attempt at 2 metres 20. And he goes clear this time. So he's got a cross on his score sheet, but he's also now got a circle, which indicates that he's got a positive outcome at his second attempt at 2 metres 20. There's one other athlete, the French Hananay, who knocked 2:20 down, and he'll be next up to jump. And here we go, his second attempt. This is Hananay from France. He's got a best of personal best of 2:32, but he has jumped 2 metres 31 in 2012. So it's not that he's not had good form this summer. Leisurely strides in, and he goes clear too. So all of the athletes, the 13 that's attempted 2:20 at their opening height, have gone clear. And Robbie Grabas from Britain has decided to pass that height, and he may well come in at 2:25, which is going to be the next height that the high jump bar goes up to. So a clearance for the Frenchman.
Well, the next event is in fact a track event, and it's the women's 100 meter hurdles. It's the semi-final heat one, and this should be good. Got the defending Olympic champion in the first heat, drawn in lane four. That's three in from the right hand. They're not using lane one. There are the records. Donkova back in 1988, 12:21. Joanna Hayes, 12:37. That's a very good Olympic record. It could be under threat this time. Well, there's the start list then. Lane two, Holder of Canada. Three, Williams, Jamaica. Four, Harper, USA. Five, Talley, Belarus. Six, Schott of Austria. Seven, Akori of France. Eight, Nitra, Germany. And nine, Galeskaya of Russia. Just the first two, so these are tough semi-final heats, these, plus the two fastest to the final. So really, It is a very, very competitive, all-out situation, as one would expect in the semi-final. There are three heats in this semi-final round. Right on the inside, Nikita Holder of Canada, sixth in the World Championship final last year, incidentally. 12.8, her best set this year. Next to her is Charmaine Williams of Jamaica. It's 13.07 in the heat. She has a 12.78 to her credit, though, this season. The defending Olympic champion, Dawn Harper, 12.75 in her heat. 12.47 her best last season. Talley of Belarus won her heat in 12.71. Medals at the World Indoor and European Championships already this year, so doing very nicely. And that Schrott of Austria, the Austrian record holder, fourth in the European Championships this year, just out of the medals. Okori, the French woman, the European Junior Champion back in 1999, Olympic semi-finalist last time, and also a semi-finalist in the World Championships held in Berlin in 2009. Caroline Nitra, European Indoor Champion last season, reached the semi-final of the Olympics last time and also the World Championships. Galitskaya of Russia, the Russian Indoor Champion, went to the World Indoor Championships, made the semi-final, 12.78 her best. As I say, the first two to go through, this is a pretty even race actually, looking down the times coming into the race. Holder, Williams, Harper, Talley, Schrott, Okori, Nitra, Galitskaya. Heat one of the semi-final round of the women's 100 meter hurdles. First two and the two fastest through to the final. Defending champion. Ooh, and that's the French woman. Yes. And that's Okori of France. I think her championship is over. It's a false start and a blatant one too, unless there was any other reason. Look at this, three from the left. That was blatant. Well, Corey, the former European champion, 12.72 this season, but I think that could be the end of her championship. I don't think there won't be a green card this time, I don't think. That was absolutely blatant. She can't believe what she's done. Well, let's get the confirmation first of all. The card is out and it is delivered. So, Corey has gone. That's a shame. So, Holder, Williams, Harper, Talley, Schrott, Nitra, Galitskaya, the athletes left as Okori leaves, the French woman. Very disappointing for her. First two and two fastest to the final. Dawn Harper drawn in lane four, that's three in. From the right as you watch. They're not using lane one. It's often confusing with the lanes, but it's a pretty even start. Certainly Harper going very strongly, so is Williams on the far side, looking very strong. And it looks as though Talley coming through, but it's... and that's a photograph for second. That's a photograph for second. 12.46 easily through the Olympic champion from 2008. But the rest coming through the line, that really was very, very tight indeed.
What is it? PB for Harper, 12.46. And then he had, as you said, Williams, Talley and Schrott almost in a line.
Yeah. Well, Schrott has been given the second place. When we look at the slow motion, we will see how close that was. Williams, they're both given the same time, Schrott and Williams. And that's interesting, isn't it? Schrott, well, Harper, forget Harper. She's won this quite comfortably. Williams was going very strongly in the early stages and still a contender in the end. Let's have a look at this. Schrott, tall blonde figure in the middle. Oh gosh, you still can't read that. You've got to rely on the photograph and on the computers, because there's no way that you can tell from that photograph. You'll have to see the slow motion, or rather the photograph to check that out. But that's a very good performance by the defending champion. It really is. And let's have another look. You can't actually see.
You need to look
you
at the
can't
photo.
See
there,
there
it
is. There it is.
Now you
yes,
can see
yes,
the
yes.
lines just a little bit. But I mean, it's so very, very close.
That is a close second place.
Well, it's crucial, of course, because only two go through. So Schrott is through, and Williams have to see whether her time is quick enough, and perhaps even Talley as well.
There it is, Harper, Schrott, Williams. But Williams will have to wait. Look at that, the same time. Look, those three, 1/100th of a second between them.
But of course, we saw Harper having her foot strapped. Well, there didn't seem to be any problem, because she's just gonna improved her personal best by 1/100th, and that's the personal best that she did in the World Championships last year.
And in the jump, long jump, we have Karin Meymelis for Turkey. She previously competed, or she was a South African who then changed allegiances, and that looks a pretty good jump. She gets the white flag. And you can see that flag fluttering around a little bit over there. She's nicely onto the board. Good speed on the runway. Good lift. And 6 meters 80. So she's a second automatic qualifier. And this is Deloach of the US of A. This is good sprinting. Oh, wow. No leg shoot. Goes over the automatic qualifying. Thank you very much. Spikes off, and she'll be going back to the village pretty quickly. That looks so easy, that was ridiculous. So, fantastically on the board, good speed, gets up off the board without having to really work too hard with the leg shoot. And that's gone over the automatic qualifying of 6.70 and 6.81. It's not a competition, this is all about getting qualifying out of the way.
John, that was into a headwind of minus 1.8 metres per second as well.
It looked ridiculously easy, didn't it? Fantastic jumping from Deloach from the USA.
Well, just getting ready for the second heat, and here is Sally Pearson, major candidate for Athlete of the Year awards last year off her brilliant sprint hurdling both in the semi-final and final of the World Championships in Daegu. So we've got two finalists from 2008 coming back here. Pearson was the silver medalist last time, and Lolo Jones was leading until she crashed into the ninth hurdle and ended up in seventh place. So she's hoping to atone for that. An athlete who's won two world indoor titles. That's Lolo Jones, who we'll see very shortly. She goes in lane four in this race. So let's meet the full field from the inside. Here is Yulia Kondakova of Russia, world indoor finalist 4 years ago. Got a best of 12.79. Next to her, an athlete who always seemed to excel when it comes to major championships. That's Derville O'Rourke, because she hasn't had much form this year, but she goes and runs a season's best of 12.91 when it comes to the heat. So she peaks very well. Here's Lolo Jones. Well, a personal best of 12.43, just outside the world all-time top 10. And she, of course, did 12.43 in Beijing in her semi-final, only to crash in the final. Aline Behrings, Belgium, former European indoor champion at 60 meter hurdles, and a junior champion on this full flight of 100 meter hurdles. Here's Jessica Zelenka. We saw her, of course, in the heptathlon, but she beat a very good field to win the Canadian title at this event. 12.65 she ran on that occasion in Calgary. Here is the favorite for the title, Sally Pearson. Looked magnificent in her heat when she ran 12.57. Last year, of course, she ran a brilliant 12.28, the fourth fastest ever. Tiffany Porter of Great Britain. Injuries question mark, but she was, of course, good in the indoor season when she took the world indoor silver medal. And finally, the Bahamas record holder, Evanique Kemp, holds that record at 13.13. So the two finalists 4 years ago in this lineup are Lolo Jones in lane four and Sally Pearson in lane seven. And Zelinka and Porter, either side of Pearson, have shown the sort of pedigree and the sort of form that make them candidates for the final as well. Sally Pearson taking to her marks in lane seven in the second of the races in the semi-final round of the women's 100-meter hurdles. Well, they're away. Pearson is already flowing away. Good run on the inside from the Russian as well. But this is all about Sally Pearson going well away from the rest of the field. A brilliant run once again by Pearson. She takes that. Zelinka of Canada came up for second place. But once again, just as she showed in Daegu, she ran a brilliant time there. It's the fastest time in the world this year. It's 12.39 for Sally Pearson, and she looks a cast-iron favourite. And once again, a brilliant demonstration of sprint hurdling, Stuart.
Yes, she does. She hurdles so well, and she's so quick. She's an 11-second flat sprinter. Lola Jones was third in my book. I thought she came through third. Zelinka's definitely got second, clearly second. But look at the way she gets to the first hurdle. Her trail leg is so quick, it brings the lead leg down so fast. But her basic speed exceeds anyone else in this race. And that's the thing that is a great advantage. But she comes off the hurdle so quickly with real momentum. And it really is a very, very fine piece of hurdling. First hurdle, establish the rhythm of the race. Get off it quick. In other words, pull the trail leg through. That means the action and reaction, the front leg will come down quickly. And she just, look at her shoulders. They stay on the same level the whole way. It's a wonderful piece of hurdling. And that is a classy time, isn't it? 12.39.
Wow. And as you said, Lolo Jones was third place. And I think 12.71 should be enough to advance. He was just ahead of Porter, 12.79. Those are both quicker than the third place in the first semi.
Yeah, it was only 200ths outside the Olympic record, that.
And now we go to the high jump. The bar has been moved up to 225, and this is Yukov from Russia. And a good clearance from Uhov. See here, just builds up nicely into the take-up area, take-off zone. Reaches up over high point nicely over the bar, and he just follows with his legs. There's some interesting taping going on these bodies that we've just seen who are taking their vest off. So this is Williams, first attempt at 2 meters 25. He cleared 220 on his first attempt. Very tidy, very compact high jumper is Jesse Williams.
Interestingly, he was only fourth in the US trials, and of course they automatically take first three, except that the man ahead of him hadn't qualified.
Well, that's an interesting fact, but he's also the 2011 world champion.
Right, he's a major contender.
Yeah, so he must have had a bit of a mare in the championships, but he's here and he's going clear. He's got two clears at 2.25.
Well, then once again looking at Sally Pearson, so beautifully balanced all the way through this hurdles race. And she wins that second semi-final in 12.39. Zelinka 12.66, and Lolo Jones may well be in the final with her 12.71. The wind was just a little bit behind that race at 1.3 meters per second.
And making his entry into the high jump competition, we have Robbie Grabas from Great Britain. He missed out on 220. He decided to come in at 225 this high. And he goes clear. And the roar from the crowd, they like that. So good speed on the runway. Runs a lovely arc as he comes into the takeoff area. And then just uses that speed to take him up. He looks pretty confident to me. So he goes clear at 225. And is now in joint first position of many.
Well, we've got the men's 800 meters semi-finals coming up. this afternoon. And of course, David Radisha. Oh, that's Khaki, in fact. Before we go to, I'm sure they'll show Radisha. Khaki, who's had indifferent form during the season, but he is certainly a threat to everyone in very good form. He really is. There's Amos. He won his heat and looked very good indeed coming into the next round, the semi-final round. Borzakovsky. He's very difficult to assess, Borzakovsky. You never know what he's going to do, whether he runs it from the front, whether he gets involved, or whether he doesn't. Aman, another of the Ethiopian competitors who will surely make his presence felt in the semi-finals. And there's David Radisha. He is by far the best 800-meter runner, is the world record holder. He's run several 800s in sub-142 this season, so... And he can do it with or without a pacemaker, I can tell you. He is so eloquent. So the third semi-final, or the third heat of the semi-final round of the women's 100 hurdles, Zagle of Belgium, Rolder of Germany, Dektyareva of Russia, Wells of the United States, Yanit of Turkey, George of Canada, Caravelli of Italy, and Skrobakova of the Czech Republic in lane 9. There are the two fastest losers so far, Jones and Porter of Great Britain. Early days though yet. Zagre, the Belgian record holder, was fifth in the European Championships just recently in Barcelona. 13.04 in qualifying. She came through as a fastest qualifier to this round. You see that small queue just being introduced to the crowd. Well, this is Cindy Rolder, a European under 23 bronze medalist last year, semi-finalist in the World Championship. She was seventh in the European Championships just recently in the final. Dekatereva of Russia, 12.81, her best, and Russian champion. Didn't get through the heats of this event last time, in 4 years ago. Now, Kelly Wells is the only one in the world that's beaten Sally Pearson of Australia. She did that last time out. But she too is somewhat erratic. You can't really say she should qualify here. But Yanit also, the Turkish twice European champion, World Student Games champion 2 seasons ago, Turkish record 12.61. She looked good in qualifying as well. And there's Felicia George of Canada, 12.72, her best. World finalist last year in Daegu, 12.83 in qualification. She qualified by right. Well, this is Caravelli of Italy, broke the Italian 100-meter hurdles record, which has stood to Tuzzi since 1994. Just broke that last year in May. And Shrabakova of the Czech Republic holds their record indoor and out. Didn't get through the semi-final of the European Championships, though, just recently. Reached the semi-final of the last two World Championships, though. So this is the third heat of the semi-final round of the women's hurdles. Zagre, Rolda, Dekrajeva, Wells, Yanit, George, Caravelli, and Strobakova. Kelly Wells had a terrific start, so did Yanit, and these two ahead with George coming through very strongly. And this is Kelly Wells at her best, really, with Yanit in second place at the moment. Wells wins it, Yanit comes into second place, in third place George, then Degrieva, and the time 12.52. That went with the form book, but Kelly Wells was second in the US Olympic trials, incidentally. It was in London where she beat Sally Pearson. That was a big upset, and Sally was very upset about that. But Kelly Wells gets that. She's through to the final later on. And that was a very good run indeed. You can't really tell how good they're going to be in the final. But you know, when you get that sort of start, The only disadvantage she has over Pearson is that Pearson is quicker on the flat, and she can make room for those hurdles with a, you know, reaction time is very, very good. Quite impressed by Yanet as well, the Turkish athlete.
And indeed, she's got a national record out of it, 12.58, and George has done a personal best, 12.65. She'll go through to the final, so too will Lola Jones, because Dektayeva here ran 12.75 in fourth.
Yeah, really attack the hurdle, lean into it, run off it, just get down to that track as quick as possible and really get stuck into the sprinting. That's what it's all about. But Kelly Wells, I expected her to get through, and so she did.
And here we go with Hanane for his third attempt at 2.25 meters. So Hanane of France will go out at the second height in this final. We started at 2.20 meters. He went clear the second attempt on that. And now he has failed three times at 2.25.
Sorry, coach, is the message.
Yeah, did my best, coach. So here, walk back, and you can see that three crosses against Mikhail Hanane's high jump scorecard. So there was an earlier failure from the Cypriot, Ayanu, who also has gone out at 2.25. So the competition now is down to its true final number of 12.
Another look at Kelly. Look at the way in which she runs off the hurdle too. Just not quite got the momentum off the hurdle that Sally Pearson demonstrated. But, she's still very much in contention for a medal, that's for sure.
Well, there were some very fine times in that series of races. There were quite a number of seasons and personal bests. And of course that list headed by the world leading mark for the year of Sally Pearson. But Dawn Harper won her heat in her personal best. Kelly Wells only just outside her best. National record for Yanet, so a really good standard. Back to the high jump. We're at the new height now of 2.29.
Prochenko of the Ukraine. He's got a clear sheet so far. His first attempts at 2.20, 2.25 have both been successful. So this is his first attempt at 2.29. And that's his first failure of the evening. And of course, this is the height that they qualified to get to this final. And this will start to find one or two of these high jumpers out. They've all gone over this during the season, but now the pressure's on in this cauldron of the stadium.
Another event which happened yesterday, which was the women's pole vault. So we have the victory ceremony for that now.
And the ladies are lining up for that pole vault celebration.
Familiar figure will take the bronze medal, but she's more used to golds.
Well, it is, you know, and times change, don't they? So she was the Olympic champion in 2004, 2008. And of course, the event was only included in the Games from Sydney in 2000.
So Prince Albert II, the head of the Principality of Monaco, of course, but also an IOC member, very keen sportsman.
Recently married to a South African swimmer, I believe.
Charlene Woodstock. Well, he's accompanied by Valentin Balakhnichev, who heads the Russian Athletics Federation, and he's the treasurer, new treasurer, in fact, of the IAF.
Well, it was an enthralling competition yesterday evening in the Olympic Stadium. And the previous winner of two gold medals in 2004-2008, Issam Bayeva, this time takes the bronze medal in the women's pole vault final. She looks pretty pleased with that. She has three medals from three games. So a fantastic achievement for Issam Bayeva, now 30 years of age. And she cleared 4.75 meters to get that bronze medal. The silver and gold were
decided at 4 meters 80, and on count back, Silva from Cuba won the silver medal. She was looking bubbly and bouncy and fast all night, and she deservedly takes the silver medal in the women's pole vault final. Great performance from the Cuban. And that was a new personal best. So the winner of the gold medal from the United States of America, Jen Schuur, who cleared 4 meters 80, same height as Cuba, but on count back she takes the gold medal. Fantastic performance from the American, and only just 1 centimeter below her season's best. She has cleared 4.92, but she didn't get to that height yesterday evening. So she's the pole vault women's gold medalist from London 2012. Jen Schuur wipes the tears from her eyes. And an emotional scene on the podium for this women's pole vault final. The medalists joining up now to display their medals. What a fantastic performance, and what a fantastic feeling it must be to stand on that podium with 80,000 people celebrating it with them.
Well, it gives us a chance to update the result of that last semi-final. Kelly Wells and Nevin Yannit and Felicia George does qualify as the fastest qualifier at 12.65. So we now know the women's final: Pearson, Harper, Wells, Yannit, George, Zelinka, Jones and Schrott. And the you can see the small queues on the fastest qualifiers, Lola Jones and Felicia George.
And here we have Bashim of Qatar, who goes clear at his first attempt at 2 meters 25. The bar just vibrating a little bit, but it stays on. He has a grin because he knows he just touched that. Let's have a look. Oh, he just catches it with the back of his thigh, the hamstrings there, so but not enough to disrupt the bar and take it off. What a great picture that is, as he goes high point well over the bar. He's just coming down on the bar. So he needs to make a slight adjustment to make sure that he doesn't touch that again. 2.29, first time clearance for Bashim from Qatar. And now lining up, we have the men's discus final. They'll be introduced to the crowd in their throwing order. Lechner, who's in this final, is the Olympic record holder with 69.89 from 2004. And on the screen, the list in throwing order comes up, and that's how they'll be introduced to the crowd. So we'll just wait for them to finish lining up in good military style, doing as they're told.
be the last time they do as they're told this evening once it all starts, I think. What a fantastic lineup of muscular, tall, beefy men. And the first one up tonight will be Vikas Gowda from India. He's the Commonwealth silver medalist from 2010 and the American, the Indian record holder. Next in line is the 20-year-old Lawrence Okoye. He qualified with his last throw in the qualifying round. 20-year-old holds the British record with 68 meters 24, and the crowd like him. Next in line is Alekna, two-time Olympic champion, 40-year-old, twice the age of Okoye. So Okoye at 20, Alekna at 40. Next is the reigning Olympic champion. This discus is loaded, I can tell you. That's Gerd Kanter from Estonia. And then we have Ben Haradine from Australia. He's the reigning 2010 Commonwealth champion and the Oceanian record holder. Next up will be Frank Casanas of Spain, the former Cuban who now competes for Spain, and he was fifth in 2008 in Beijing for Spain. Hadabi from Iran is next in line to throw at number seven. And he won a bronze medal in the World Championships in 2011. The Cuban, Fernandez, will be eighth to throw. Eric Caddy from the Netherlands, 28-year-old, will be ninth in line. And he's a former European junior champion. And then we have Robert Harting from Germany. He's unbeaten in 28 finals since August 2010. And he's twice the world champion. And he's going to be difficult to beat. He was fourth in Beijing, so he'll be hungry for an Olympic medal. Malachowski from Poland. He won the silver in Beijing in 2008. And to wrap the contest up, we have the German Martin Viereg, the 25-year-old, who is experiencing the Olympics for the first time. And meanwhile, down at the high jump, is starting to warm up a little bit. Second time clearance at 225. Kinnard from the USA is having his first attempt at 2 meters 29. And that's a good clearance for Kinnard. It rattles, but it didn't look as if it was going to fall. So he has a quick word with it. He is remarkably quick on the runway. Just clipped it with his heels. Seemed to have a lot of vertical speed into the takeoff area. Just needs to get that, arch that back just a little bit more as he goes over. Now we have Derek Druin of Canada. And Druin goes clear at 2:29. Comfortable clearance from the Canadian. He's got a season's best of 2 metres 31. And you can see that he rolls and wraps himself beautifully around that bar. So he's got a clear score sheet, the Canadian. Three clear clearances, first time up on each of the three heights he's attempted so far. Now we have Juana Miller of Colombia. Again, clean scorecard, two clearances at the early height, first time. And that's his first failure. So the Colombian comes in, looks as though he's a bit steep and really didn't get any sort of real bite on his takeoff foot to get up off it as he came in on that angle. And Lawrence Okoye in the circle for his first throw of the evening in the discus event. And it just goes over 60 metres. It's certainly better than his qualifying round throw, the first one, which nearly decapitated a couple of photographers who were just on the sector at about 40 metres. So that'll settle his nerves, this
giant young man, 6'8". And just 20 years old, 68, over 68 metres now he's thrown this year to break the British record. So we're just waiting for that distance to come up for Lawrence Okoye in his first round throw. And then down at the high jump, Robbie Grabas is coming up for his first attempt at 2:29. He has a serious look on his face. Great clearance from Grabas, first time, and the crowd roars in appreciation. And his score sheet at the moment looks the best of the lot. He missed out on 220, decided not to start at that height, came in at the second height of 225. He cleared that first time. These are great pitches. Look at the height he gets over that bar. He probably just needs to come in a fraction close because the high point was just ahead of the bar, but he won't worry. 229 on his first attempt. He's got a clean sheet. So Alekna comes into the circle for his first throw tonight. And that's well over 65 metres. It was a bit of a war in the warm-up. I was just trying to keep an eye on the throws here, and they were peppering. Several guys were peppering the 65-metre line. What fantastic movement across. 40-year-old. This Alekna, he does the active reverse, he keeps his head up, his shoulders high, he's a huge man, he's at least 6'10" tall, and he starts off with his first throw, a throw that extends way past that 67-38. What an opening throw from Alekna.
Great speed, wasn't there?
Well, it's fantastic, isn't it? And you know, for a man of 40, you can't keep the old ones out of these competitions. They keep coming back. Kanter, the reigning Olympic champion from 2008. He won't want to give his title away too easily. Well, it's not a bad effort, and it just goes over that 65-metre line. The red line there is what Alekna hit on his first round throw, and it's certainly two and a half metres past what Kanter has achieved. But again, that will settle the nerves. Kanter, again, using active reverse. We'll see later when Harting comes in the circle, he uses the fixed feet style of throwing, so it's a great demonstration of the two styles that are going to be operating in this final tonight. Lawrence Okoye, he also uses fixed feet. 65.07. So currently in second position as we are in the early stages of this discus competition. I have a feeling it's going to be hot tonight down there. So this is Bondarenko, and he goes clear. He's happy with that. He had a first-time failure at 2:29, and I think he's pretty pleased with that. Seemed to take off a long way away from the bar, but he does roll over. He does extend and arches back and gets a good clearance on his second attempt at 2:29.
Well, meanwhile, we're back on the track, and we've got the 800 metres. We've got three semi-finals coming up for that.
And let's take you through the competitors in the first of those. There is the records to begin with. Look at that, 141.01. Rodal, 142. There's some very, very fine performances this season already.
Well, we'll come back to that in a moment.
Here we have Yuhov of Russia. He's having his second attempt at 2:29, and he goes clear. So there are stacking up down at the high jump end, where clearances are just raining in over this height of 2:29. Again, great foot placement. That takeoff foot taking all the pressure. Up he goes, transfers that horizontal speed to the vertical, and he arches over 2:29 on his second attempt.
Well, there is the lineup. Bechana of Brazil, Moradi of Iran, Kaki of Sudan, Kishot of Poland, Chemut of Kenya, Amos of Botswana, Marco of Spain, and La Powers of the Netherlands outside in lane 9. It's the first two plus the two fastest to the final, so this has got to be a true run race in every sense. It's going to be a tough one too. What form is Kaki in? Is he in the sort of form that we've seen last year when he was the world number two? He's twice the world indoor champion. He loves to front run, but we've seen him doing otherwise recently. That's Pacana, four times the South American champion. This event, 1:45.31, his best. That's the time in which he qualified, bottom left of your screen. And second in his heat, actually, to qualify for this first heat of the semi-final round. Maradi, the Iranian record holder, indoors an eight at this event, 1:45.98 this season. Well, here's Abubakar Kaki. Erratic, yes. His best is 1:42.23 a couple of seasons ago, but erratic form this year. Now, Kashot is a good tactician, European indoor champion, European under 23 champion a couple of seasons ago. I saw him win the Diamond League race in London just before these championships. Chemot, the Kenyan, he's only 19. He was the Kenyan number three from their trials. And you've got David Rudisha in your team, then you find it tough. This is Nigel Amos of Botswana, world junior champion. 1:43.11 at the age of 18, so how about that? Uninhibited, full of promise. Marco, semi-finalist in the World Championships last year, was third in his heat. So 1:45.14, his best set this season. And then Lathawas of the Netherlands was sixth in the European Championships. He led the race into the finishing straight and got run down. He was second in his heat here. But only two to go through by right and two fastest to the final on Thursday. The first heat of this semi-final round of the men's 800 metres. World junior champion on the left, the Spaniard, Marco. Just waiting to be called forward. Nervous moments indeed. I wonder what thoughts are going through his mind. Just waiting for the exact time at which this race is scheduled to go. So the first heat of the men's 800 metres underway. It'll be very interesting to see who actually takes it on from the first bend and establishes it. Kaki, who loves to front run, saw him in the World Indoor Championships a few seasons ago, and he was a man who really enjoyed that. Pechana of Brazil has gone into, well, I was going to say into second place, but he's not now because the Kenyan Chemut is up there as well. And this is really quite quick. They really are motoring now. In fact, it's Amos in second place. So Kaki leads, Amos in second place, Chemot in third place, the Spaniard Marco in fourth place, then Maradi, and the man who was in second for a brief moment, Pichano, finds himself free from the back now. But watch out for Kashot. He's right at the back of this group at the moment, and it is quite quick, isn't it? It's 51.01 at 400 metres, so this is going to be a very, very quick race.
Well, Kaki loves to front run, as you said, and he is making sure that it is a quick race, because with just two to go through from a semi-final, we've had some slip-ups sometimes in tactical affairs, and he's determined to run this his own way.
Yes, he is. A real battle between Amos, the world junior champion, and Chemut, the Kenyan. They're in second and third, and Hamad and Maradi of Iran is now in fourth place. And here comes Kashot on the outside. I said, watch out for him. He's a very good tactician. The pole is coming into third place. He needs to be in the top two. He's attacking Amos now. Kaki, who's faded in the home straight just recently, may well do the same again, or is he? Kaki and Amos, the world junior champion, coming through, and Kaki's holding on. So Amos and Kaki will be the two qualifiers from this race, and it's Kaki that gets it. Amos in second, Kashot in third, then Chemut in fourth. But 1:44.51, well, Kaki established the tenor of that race, and 1:44.51 is a good time, and he looks as though, I thought just for a minute, he was going to falter down the straight, but not so.
And in the discus we have Haddadi from Iran coming in for his first throw of the evening in this final. He's strapped up on his shoulder. Oh, my word, look at that. That's gone into the lead. So he's gone further than Alekna. And despite all that tape around his right shoulder, the red line indicates the lead so far, and that's Alekna's throw, 67, over 67 metres. And that's an active reverse, and he really gets hold of that. And I think we've got a really hot discus competition this evening. Just waiting for the distance to come up, but he likes it. He's got every type of taping around that shoulder, holding it in, and he can't quite believe it. 68-18, and he takes the lead so far in this first round of the discus final for men.
On his way to a bit of history, perhaps. Iran have never even had a finalist in the Olympics at any event before. Could be a medal now, but here's the favourite, Robert Harting.
Harting of Germany. Fixed feet, left foot hits the front of the rim and just stays there, and that goes over. I don't think that's quite as good as Haddadi. So, just watching this, what a great athlete Harting is. He's won every final for the last couple of years, an unbeaten run of 28 finals. Fantastic flight. We've got a nice wind out there tonight for the discus boys. And ...67-79. He goes into second place behind Haddadi's 68-18. So this first round has been hot in this discus tonight. And Silnov down at the high jump is struggling. He's had two failures at 229. What can he do on his last attempt? Harness down. So Silnov is out of the high jump. He's gone out at 229. He sits second in the world this year at 237. He goes out at 239. So that's a bit of a shock in the high jump. One of the leading contenders for medals is now out of the competition at 2 meters 29. So next to jump in the high jump is Williams of USA, his third attempt at 229, and he's out too. So the world champion from 2011, Williams, he goes out. It may be, put in a new phrase, he's caught a Silnov, because Silnov, he went out, as we saw earlier, and now Williams goes out too. So there are some shocks that are happening in this high jump final.
Meanwhile, what wonderful tactics really by Kaki to make sure that there was a good pace in that 800, 144.51, because he made sure that the likes of Schott couldn't use his fabled sprint finish there, and Schott was only third.
Yeah, he was. Kaki and Amos were way ahead, weren't they? 144.51, the winning time.
So that's the first of the three races in the men's 800 metres. And here is a familiar face, or a familiar back view, I should say, perhaps, at the moment. Yuri Borzakovsky, former champion, also was a finalist back in 2000 in Sydney. Hasn't run anything spectacular this year, but he did win the European title, but no quick times. Quick times, however, have been achieved by this man, Nick Simmons of the USA. Five successive US titles now to his credit. Sixth and fifth in the last two world championships. So just seeing some of the favorites in this, the lineup then for the second semi-final of the men's 800 meters. Gonzalez of Cuba, Bala of Qatar, Borzakovsky of Russia, Lopez of Spain, Lewandowski of Poland, Simmons, USA, Rudisha, the one and only world record holder from Kenya, Osaji of Great Britain, and Mohamed of Egypt. This is Andy Gonzalez, the Cuban, who won the Pan American title last year, and this year the Ibero-American title. It's a good championship competitor. It's not quite so quick as some of the runners, just outside 145, his personal best. This man, Musaib Abdulrahman Bala, was the Arab Games champion last year. Comes from Qatar, and also with a man with the best just outside 145. Borzakowski, well, at his best, 142.47 is the eighth fastest of all time. But of course, we've got so accustomed to him hanging back. But he can't afford to do that with the likes of the runners that he's got in this race. Kevin Lopez of Spain, he's taken the national record, which was set 10 years ago by Rayner, who we'll see in the next race. And he's now run 143.74 this year. This is Marcin Lewandowski, European champion 2 years ago, and Polish athlete. Again, a fast man with the best of 143.84. Nick Simmons, twice a world championship finalist, semi-finalist in the last Olympics, and five times the US champion. And here is the man who's really taken the 800 meter event by storm since he first appeared, David Rudisha. Two world records to his credit, and he's producing a pretty useful championship record since he took the world junior title 6 years ago. Rudisha. Andrew Osaji, the British champion now, had a fine performance in the world indoors in Istanbul this winter, and he took the bronze medal, the crowd giving him every support. And finally, we have Hamada Mohamed of Egypt, second in the Pan Arab Games last year. But Rudisha, 141.54, he ran in the Paris Saint-Denis Diamond League meeting, a second and a half quicker than anyone else has managed this year. His father took an Olympic silver medal at the relay, and he'll want to go one better than that. Semi-final two of the 800 meters with David Rudisha out in lane seven. Just interesting to see how he runs this race. He's capable, of course, of dominating it any way he wants to. And already he's just shading it a little bit, maybe. No, he's content to see Gonzalez of Cuba taking up the running. But now the long striding Rudisha goes past Gonzalez. And it is Rudisha, immediately followed by the Spaniard, Kevin Lopez. And he's decided to run it rather like Kharki did in the previous race, to run it away from the field, make sure there's no problems, make sure there's no tripping or anything like that, make sure he runs at a pace that no one else can match, perhaps. He's controlled.
Yeah, he is. He's been asking for 48.5, 49 second first 400s on the Diamond League circuit, and really he's very, very competitive. Look at Borzakowski. He knows where the danger is, and he knows that he's got to put the pressure on. But look at that little increase of pace as soon as Borzakowski came up onto his shoulder, and Rudisha goes away again. And you watch, there's a subtle increase of pace, and slowly he'll move away. It's not obvious, but he's gone.
But look, Borzakowski is running a very different type of race, isn't it? He knows he's got to run it differently against Rudisha. He's tracked by Nick Simmons. Osaji of Great Britain's getting the support of the crowd as he's just behind Lewandowski, the Pole in fourth place. So, 600 metres going through in 1:17.81, nearly identical to Kharki's time in the previous race. So it is David Rudisha, this great 800 metre runner, who comes into the home straight, the battle on for the second place. Simmons challenging Borzakowski. Here he goes there, Rudisha running away from the field. Andrew Osaji of Great Britain is coming up to challenge Nick Simmons, the battle on for second place. Rudisha has won it. Osaji has taken second. Simmons is in third. Borzakowski is fourth. Lewandowski is in fifth. A long way clear of the Spanish record holder, Lopez, who is sixth, and the other three men trailing in behind them. 1:44.35. David Rudisha. Oh, he looks a class apart. But Osaji is dancing in joy down there at the finish as well. The British athlete who's got through into second place with a fine run. Well, they must all be pretty pleased that Rudisha led them through to some quick times there. Simmons, 1:44.87, that probably will be enough to take him through to the final as well. Beautiful, beautiful sight there.
Well, that was interesting, wasn't it? Borzakowski tried to take the man on. Watch this. And then as soon as he came alongside, just increased the pace a little, wouldn't let him in, wouldn't let him pass, and then all of a sudden he just moves ahead. Look, there's no way around him, and he just moves away again. And in the home straight, look at Osaji for Great Britain. He's in what, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth place, and running against Simmons of the United States, who's on the right, on the in the all red strip. And it's a real battle between those two, but Osaji gets himself into the final by right, with this being one of the two to qualify, and Simmons will have to wait with the others to see whether they can be the two, one of the two fastest qualifiers. But this man is just a different class. That is absolutely majestic, isn't it? Beautiful, beautiful running. He doesn't need pacemakers, although he uses them. He uses his training partner as one, but Fantastic.
So Eric Kinnard is lining up to take his first attempt at 2 meters 33. He's got a personal best that was set in this year of 2 meters 34, so he's just getting very close to what he's achieved. So he goes clear. So first time clearance for Kinnard at 2 meters 33. And whereas a lot of these guys haven't been coping with the increase in the height, Kinnard comes in and nails his first attempt at 2 meters 33. Ukov of Russia, his first attempt at 2:33. And he goes clear as well. So we're getting a better run now of clearances, which is fascinating to see. Things are hotting up on the high jump D. And he just curls his way over that, just arches the spine, and he just gets over that very comfortably indeed. So, two clearances at 2 meters 33. And next into the circle for his second throw is Malachowski. He won the silver medal in Beijing in 2008. Well, there you go, that's put it out. That bronze line there is the bronze medal position as we come to the end of the second round. So Malachowski, the pole, is very close to that. He's not quite going to get into the third position at the moment, but he's certainly setting things up nicely to make a progression. As we're only in the second round, he's jumping up and down. He likes it. And he doesn't know just yet that he's just under that third medal position, but it's put him in a much stronger position than his 62.50 in the first round. 66.92, and he's in now fourth position.
Well, meanwhile, the long jump's been going on, and Brittany Rees, the favourite, in trouble with two no jumps. We saw those three automatic qualifiers very early on in the competition. Well, nearly running just in time, just in within the minute. Now, what can Brittany Rees do? Oh, well, that's much better. Is it a legal jump? I think it is. Yes, the white flag goes up. So, living dangerously, but jumping into a slight headwind and produces the goods when it matters. Oh, phew. Relief. Relief, because Rees, of course, heads the world list, world champion, very much the favorite. And, phew, finally comes up with the goods. Hits the board quite nicely there after those two no jumps, so perhaps he did a little bit of adjustment. And there's the leading performance. We saw early on Proctor and Melis May and Deloach going into the automatic qualifying slots. And now Brittany Rees has joined them. Let's just have a look at the distance. That's enough. Oh, 6.57. Looked better than that.
It did, didn't it? But there you go.
Just looking at David Rudisha, so comfortable in contrast to those following him. There's the result of it, 144.35. Andrew Asagi, brilliant performance, 144.74. Qualified by Wright. The rest must wait because there's one more heat in this semi-final round.
Just going back to that long jump, it looked much further. She must have touched down with her hand or something just before.
I think she did. I think you're right.
The third semi-final, there's the lineup for you. Harris of Canada, Mohammed of Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Solomon of USA, Aman of Ethiopia, Keetum of Kenya, Olivier of South Africa, Boss of France, and Reina of Spain. This is Harris, the Canadian champion. 145.97 is his best set this year in the heat. In fact, qualified by Wright, he was second in his heat, and he's got the inside lane. This is Mohammed of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, 145.52, another personal best set this season. He's 21 years old. And this is Dwayne Solomon, the US indoor champion last year, third in the Olympic trials, but he's third in Monaco, and his personal best down to 143.44. So Aman, the Ethiopian, a record holder by the age of 17, he's only 18, 143.51. Won his heat. So many youngsters coming to the fore in these Olympic Games. That's Tim Kiptum, I should say, of Kenya. He's only 17, 143.94 as well.
when you consider the sheer youth, Olivier of South Africa, he set his personal best in that Monaco race, 145.09 to 144.29. He was third in his heat here. And this is Bossa, France. Got a bronze in the Europeans in Barcelona recently. Pierre Bus, 144.97. Well, Reiner came here as the Spanish record holder, but goes away. His teammate has taken it from him, so he's the former Spanish record holder now. Olympic semi-finalist in the last two Olympics, incidentally, so he's a good competitor. But once again, the first two plus two fastest through to the final on Thursday. Amman of Ethiopia, 18. Keaton, 17. Bos, 20. The youth emerging, and Harris has gone off pretty quickly on the inside. And so has Olivier. Olivier, the South African. And Solomon of the United States, also in the centre in the all-red strip. We'll see who comes across. I think it could be Amman, actually, when they emerge, but we'll see. No, it's Solomon from Amman down at the back straight as they go through the 200-metre mark for the first time. The Frenchman, Buss, in third place. The Canadian, Harris, is tucked in on the inside now in third place as they enter the home straight for the first time. So Solomon controlling the race at the moment. Amman in second, Harris third, Bos fourth. Then Mohamed and Keaton, the other youngster, with the Spaniard trailing at the back at the moment with the South African Olivier. 51.18, a very respectable time indeed. And we shall see now how this second lap opens up. The American really putting the button down now as they go into the back straight, followed by Amman. The Ethiopian record holder, he got that record by the age of 17 in the red and green of Ethiopia there. But this is not over. Keaton, the youngster's coming through into third place ahead of Bus of France. And now the South African making some move. Olivier really hammering away. But it's only the first two to go through by right. The two youngsters are up in the first three, chasing the more experienced American. And Solomon leads. And Amman in second place, Keaton really working hard, and Solomon could be the one to be run out of this, having led all the way through, and he's going to be. The two youngsters are through. It's Amman who wins, and Keaton in second place, Solomon in third, and the time 144.34, and youth prevailed once again. That was a very, very good run by Amman and Keaton, both of them very strong in the home straight. So there really is a new group of 800 meter runners coming into the four, and it's good to see, isn't it? Mohamed Amman, 144.34. Wow.
And down at the high jump, Robbie Grabars from Great Britain has his first attempt at 2.33. Oh, he just seemed to just duck into that takeoff point, just sink a fraction, and didn't quite get up off it clean, although it's just tries to arch over it and just catches it with the back of his calves. So Grabars, who's had a clean score sheet, 2.25 first time, 2.29 first time, has his first failure of the evening.
Well, this is where Solomon came under pressure from the two youngsters. He'd led all the way, looked to be totally in control, but just didn't have the power down the home straight. I mean, he's a 143 man at his best, is Solomon, but he couldn't hold on the two youngsters, Kittum, I should say, and Amman, the leader there, the Ethiopian. He's a very good find, isn't he? And the Kenyan trailing him home.
Nonetheless, Solomon has made it. He broke 145 and has got through to the final.
Yes, there it is, the small queue. That confirms that. Amman and Kittum and Solomon does go through. And no doubt we'll get a list of all those who've actually gone through shortly.
Derek Druin, meanwhile, in the high jump, his second attempt at 2.33.
And that's his second failure at 2.33. So these heights are now finding out, these high jumpers. We had 14. It whittled down to 7 as we came into 2.33. And now we're starting to feel the strain.
But this is the composition of the final, or will be the composition of the final of the 800 metres. Three teenagers, three men who will be juniors next year. Amman there, and Amos, and Keaton. Rudisha, of course, looking absolutely supreme. Simmons and Solomon got through on times. So anyone who broke 1:45. Interesting that all the semis were fast, and we haven't seen that in recent championships. One notable failure, just missing out, Borzakowski.
And here we have Michael Mason with his second attempt at 2 meters 33. Oh, that was very, very close indeed. He had two failures at 2:29. Now he's had two failures at 2:33. Just clipped it with his heels as he nearly just arched his way over it. Just didn't get those feet up quickly enough. And he'll need to do a rescue operation on his third attempt, like he did at 2:29, where he went over and cleared it on his third attempt. So Robbie Grabas comes into his second attempt at 2 meters 33. That was very close indeed. I mean, the previous jumper, Michael Mason, got close and just clipped it, and Grabas has done the same. He's curled over and just caught it and flicked the bar off. He can't quite believe it. He felt that he got it, but you could just see he got it with his rump there and just tickled the bar, and that's gone down. So he's had two failures. Moment, he's equal third in the high jump. So, getting the crowd going here, we have Bondarenko from the Ukraine, and he's got his third and final attempt at 2 meters 33. He needs to go clear. He had failures earlier, and that's down. So Bondarenko is the next high jumper to exit the competition, and he'll end up in around seventh position because of those early favours and the countback system.
Well, we always keep a check on what's going on just outside the arena. Nick Willis, yawning at the moment. I'm sure he'll wake up in time for the 1500 metre final, which of course we'll have later today. Willis and looking in really terrific form. He's up against, of course, three formidable Kenyans, the defending champion, Asbel Kiprop, twice world champion, but with an injury problem. We think he's carrying an injury, so may not be at prime form. Tewfik Maglufi, who ran away from the field in both heat and semi-final, bit of a controversy, he then ran the 800 metres and stopped, was disqualified, but put back in again as we come back to a crucial attempt for the Qatar man, Bashim, in the high jump.
And it's his third and final attempt. So this is it. He's got to go clear if he wants to stay in the competition. Oh, my word. All these high jumpers are right at the top of their game, and they're just clipping it as they go over. So Bashim, with that failure, is in equal third position. And he caught it with the back of his thigh, so his hamstrings just got in the way there. So you can see a clear sheet all the way through to 2:33. And he started the competition at 2:20. So three clearances on his way to those failures at 2:33.
Well, Fraser Price, the champion at 100 metres here, defended her 100 metres title, 10:75, goes in the third heat of the semi-final round of the women's 200 metres coming up. And she will be a contender again.
We are now coming up, in fact, for those semi-finals, three of them. So the first set of competitors already out there on the track. Well, I don't think anyone's going to get near those that world record which Flo Jo set when she won in Seoul in 1988. And of course, Alison Felix is only 0.3 behind this year. Now there's the lineup in the first race, and we feature a couple of the 100 meter medalists in this race, with Carmelita Jetta going in 7 and Veronica Campbell-Brown in 9. The highly promising world junior champion Antonique Strawn also in this field. Good experience for an athlete that I think we're going to be seeing a lot of in the future. First two to go through really is tough when you have these three races at the semi-final stage, and then another two on times. But of course, the wind can be variable, and that can affect times when we come to different races. 200 meters. There's Carmelita Jetta in the red there. She goes in lane 7 here. See more of her at 100 meters, but she's a formidable 200 meter runner as well. So let's go through the lineup. From the US Virgin Islands, we have Alison Peter, ran exactly 23 seconds in her heat to qualify. And she holds the national record at 22.77. So she's just being introduced to the crowd now. Yvette Lalaba, European 100 meter champion, usually concentrates on that distance, but she has run 200 in 22.51. This athlete was a surprise winner from the outside lane of the European title 2 years ago. Miriam Soumaray of France ran 22.32 2 years ago. This is Antonique Strawn. Takes a little while to get into a running, but a beautifully smooth, flowing athlete. The youngster, 18 years of age. Antonique Strawn from the Bahamas, world junior champion. Then another champion. This is this year's European champion, Maria Riemien of Ukraine. Ukraine having a formidable group of women sprinters right now. Then Carmelita Jetta. Well, she was the silver medalist in the 100 meters. And she's run this distance in 22.11, the fourth fastest in the world this year. Well, a local athlete, Margaret Adoy, runs for Enfield Haringale, very nearby London Borough to where we are in the stadium. And she ran a personal best of 22.94 in her heat. And finally, Veronica Campbell-Brown, the champion of 2004, the champion of 2008, one of the all-time great sprinters, took the bronze in the 100 meters. Veronica Campbell-Brown from Jamaica goes in the outside lane. So two vastly experienced athletes, medalists already in these games, Jetta in 7 and Campbell-Brown in 9, with just the first two sure to go through to the final. First semi-final, women's 200 meters. Carmelita Jetta in lane 7. Oldest in the field at 32. So off we go then. Soumaray of France has got off to a very fast start, so to Riemian of Ukraine. But the big names, Jetta in the red and Campbell-Brown in the outside, being challenged by Soumaray. But here comes Veronica Campbell-Brown flowing through, and it is the big two. It's going to be Veronica Campbell-Brown from Jetta, and then dipping for the line there at Soumaray, just ahead of Riemian. And 22.32 shown there on the clock, and it's a season's best for Veronica Campbell-Brown. This is her prime event, and she's obviously rounding into form nicely on her way to what will be the final later. So Veronica Campbell-Brown wins that semi-final, and Carmelita Jetta also through.
This is Robbie Grabas to take his third and final attempt at 2 meters 33. He needs this. There are three athletes that are in equal third position at the moment. If he goes clear, he goes clear third in the competition. Oh dear, and he just caught it, and he'll curse that, but he applauds the crowd because They've given him great support tonight. And he goes out at 2.33, along with, you can see clean sheets there, in the earlier heats. He entered the competition at 225, cleared 229 first attempt. Great concentration, gets up to the high point, and again just catches it on the way over as he tries to arch over the bar. And Fuzz Ahmed, the coach, slams his hand down. Can't do much about that, Fuzz, but great attempt from Gravas. But he goes out at 233. There's three athletes that have gone clear up to that point the first time.
Just going back to look again at the slow motion of that first heat of the semi-final. Certainly Campbell Brown was the target on the outside and she looked very good. But I have to say, Sumari of France was very, very strong all the way in this race, and she was putting real pressure on Carmeleta Jetta. Jetta, I think, was easing down a little bit at the end, and these two in the end clearly prevailed, didn't they, with Campbell Brown ahead of Jetta and ahead of Sumari. But the time, very quick, 22:32 for Campbell Brown, and easing down. So, you know, it looks as though we could be looking at sub 22. We could.
Well, there's the result. Veronica Campbell Brown 22:32 and Carmeleta Jetta 22:39, and then Sumare running easily her season's best of 22:56, just ahead of Riemian, third and fourth.
So we have two jumpers remaining in this high jumper competition. We're going to battle it out now for the gold medal. First up to jump is Eric Kleinard at 236. Sorry, there are three competitors because one of the USA guys is moving one of his attempts to this height. So first time up for Kleinard. He goes, comes down with the bar. And Jamie Nieto had two failures at 233, and he shifted one of his attempts to the next height of 236. So it's a gamble, but it may be worth taking. You can see here Kleinard catching it on the way up. So it's a failure for him at his first attempt at 2 meters 36. We'll go over and talk to the coaches now. You can see he had failure at 225 and then got... And then he got moving, and he had... Right, Haddadi, fourth row, now in reverse order. So he's the last to go in this fourth round. And he's consistently over that 65-metre line this evening. He went 68-18 on his first attempt tonight, and that's kept him in the lead all through the competition so far. But they're stacking up behind him, very smooth and rhythmical across the circle. Great active reverse at the front, where you can see he just rotates round on delivery, and it's coming down again, just displaying a fantastic series of throws. So 66.98, look at that series, 68.18, and then he hasn't gone below 66 metres all night. Here we have Yukov in the high jump. First attempt, 2 metres 36. Oh, and he goes clear. So, what a great clearance that was. It's rattling in his stands, but it doesn't matter. It's stayed up. So, Yukov so far is the only man to go clear at 2 metres 36. A great speed on the runway. That left foot plants down. He takes off. He gets up. He arches over that. The high point right in the right place. And he celebrates because he deserves to. 2 metres 36, first time of clearance. That's a great jump.
Second heat then in the semi-final round of the 200 metres. Arimata of Cyprus drawn in lane 2. Dos Santos, Brazil 3. Felix, USA 4. Ahure, Ivory Coast 5. Hackett, Trinidad and Tobago 6. Jones Ferret, US Ivory Coast in 7. Simpson, Jamaica 8. And Brzgina, Ukraine in 9. This is Arimata of Cyprus, 23.09, personal best. Or rather, a season's best equaled in the qualification for this semi-final. But she came through as a fastest loser. Dos Santos, the Brazilian, South American junior champion some years ago, quarterfinalist in the last Olympic Games 4 years ago. Got a best of 22.99. Alison Felix, of course, winner of a record of 8 world championship goals outside, 3 world championship 200 meter medals. Well, Alison Felix is terrific at 200 and 400 meters. Ahure is really, this is Muriel Ahure of the Ivory Coast, has really come on. She was 7th in the 100 in her new personal best of 10.99. And she's running well. Seymour Hackett of Trinidad and Tobago, the Central American and Caribbean champion at 100 meters last season. 22.81 in her heat. And this is Jones Ferret, Laverne Jones Ferret of the US Virgin Islands. She's their record holder at all the sprint events, right up to and including 400 meters. 22.64 in qualification. This is Sharon Simpson of Jamaica, Commonwealth champion in 2006. She defeated Veronica Campbell on that day. World fastest in both sprints, actually, back in 2006. And Brizgina, well, what a pedigree. Both her parents were Olympic champions. Olga Vladyukina in the 400 meters in 88, and Viktor Brizgin in the 4x100 meter relay in the same Olympics. That's mum and dad. A lot to live up to, I would think. So Artemata, Dos Santos, Felix, Ahure, Hackett, Jones Ferret, Simpson, Brizgina. Heat two of the semi-final round of the women's 200 metres, the first two and the two fastest to the final tomorrow. Felix looked so good in the heat. Well, actually, Felix didn't get away particularly well, but outside Ahure really had the better start, and now Felix is starting to take over as they come into the straight. Look at that for a transition. That was superb. Ahure is there, Jones Ferret and Hackett, but this is certainly Felix coming through. Ahure is going to come into second place, yes, and in third place was Samoa Hackett of Trinidad and Tobago, 22.32. Not the greatest start, but what about the transition off the bend into the straight? She just flew off the bend. That's as good as it gets, I'm telling you.
So in the high jump, we have Eric Kienard, who had a first-time failure at 2.36, but the bar's been put up to 2.38, so he's going to take his remaining two attempts. He may only need one, but he's got two attempts at 2.38. To try and knock Juhov, who went clear at 2 meters 36, off that gold medal position. Nope, on the first attempt, his high point was in front of the bar, and he has a discussion with the bar just to say, you stay up there, please. So he only has one more attempt. Serious intent at the bar, but he seemed just to take off too far away and didn't quite get the high point. You need to get that high point right above the bar, then arch over it, and that just flicks the lower limbs just over the bar and you get a clearance. So he's made an adjustment to his run-up. And now we have Yukov, who's actually got three attempts. What a great run of jumps. What a great run of jumps he's had. He's had just one failure this evening. So it's Yukov, first attempt. Oh, and he's gone clear. So the pressure is on the American now, because he's only got one jump left. But Yukov goes clear first time at 2 meters 38. He's on form, he's on fire in this high jump final, and cements himself at the top of the field. The 14 high jumpers came in. He's now at the top of that field. He's number one, and Kienard has an opportunity, one more attempt, to try and join him on 2.38.
He passes his second attempt, and it's the only attempt he has at
think Kennard may well pass at this height as well. He's got only jump left. He's got to out-jump Yukov, of course, after the splendid form the Russian's shown. So Kennard may try 240.
Yep, the only way he's going to win the gold is if he goes over 240 and Yukov fails. But the way this boy's jumping tonight, he's in a rhythm, isn't he? And once it's like any of the field events, like long jump, triple jump, javelin, or the hammer, the discus, you get into a rhythm, you lay down, you're confident on your feet. He's confident, he's smiling, he's having fun, he's at the top of the roster.
Well, Yukov has jumped 240 before, but only indoors, and he's got 239 outdoors. We look at this majestic performance by the queen of 200-meter running, Alison Felix.
Yeah, it was a marvellous piece of running. The bend, very steady, but the straightway, and coming off the bend into the straightway, it was just as though she accelerated out, that transition that we call it, and that was really brilliant, it was. Uhure was having a terrific season, managed to hang on for second place. 22.31, 22.49 for Uhure.
And also, just look at Kennard first.
Kennard, 2 meters 40, and is down. So he holds his head. He'll take the silver medal tonight. There are three jumpers in equal third position, and Yukov is going for it. He's not finished. He's not jumping up and down. He's not celebrating the fact he's got the gold medal. He's going to go for this, and he wants it.
I was just going to say, in third place there, Seymour Hackett, slightly quicker than the previous semi, and has equaled the national record of Trinidad, 22.55. And here we now have the third semi-final of the women's 200 metres, and the Sanya Richards-Ross, already the winner of the 400 metres, runs in five, and Sally-Ann Fraser-Price, the winner of the 100 metres, runs in lane four. So from the inside, Crystal Emmanuel of Canada. She's got a best of 22.90, so she's quite close to that in qualifying with that time there shown in the bottom left of the screen at 23.10. Then we have Kay Selvon of Trinidad. She's run 22.85, also a wind assisted 22.66, a college student in the USA. And now Shelley Ann Fraser-Price. Now, she doesn't run the 200 so often, but the ever-smiling Jamaican won a national title in 22.10 this year. That just shows you how good she is at the longer distance, as well as the 100, in which she retained her Olympic title. Up against the woman who won the 400, Sanya Richards-Ross. So they're coming together at this halfway distance. Richards-Ross, 22.09 this year, the second fastest in the world. Alexandra Fedoreva, the Russian 200-meter runner who moved up to 400 indoors this season and took the world indoor silver medal. Then the youngster he was a youngster when she got to the final in 2004, Abby Oyepitan. She'd just love to do so again. And we have Janelle Redhead of Grenada, 22-year-old, best just inside 23 seconds. And on the outside, the Ukrainian Kristina Stoy, World Championship finalist, an athlete with the best of 22.66. So very much the favoured athletes, the two Olympic champions already this year. Fraser-Price in four, Richards-Ross in five. The major challenge likely to come from Fedoreva just outside them in lane six. So there we are, the 100 meter champion and the 400 meters champion. Well, away they go in the inside, Fraser-Price just inside Richards-Ross, both those two going well into their running, and Fedoreva as expected on the outside Stoy, but it's now Fraser-Price, the Jamaican, in the form of her life when she showed the 100 metres, but now back comes Richards-Ross, challenging hard, it's going to be close between the two of them. Richards Ross makes it on the line, but of course Fraser Price was easing up. Winning time of 22.31. Well, what a final we're going to have. We've already had semi-final wins from Veronica Campbell-Brown and Alison Felix, two of the all-time greats, and two more all-time great sprinters joining them in the leading four when we come to the final. Sanya Richards Ross winning that race in 22.30.
And in the discus, we have Kanter, who's come into the circle for his fifth attempt. 66.02 in the third round is his best tonight. And I think he likes that. He's making remonstrations in the circle. And the reigning Olympic champion thinks he's got hold of that. It's just that line there is the gold medal position currently held by Adabi of Iran. And it's very, very close to that. Great sweep across with that right leg. Active reverse, he goes round a couple of times and he gives the biggest shout of the night. Look at that discus fly, it's flat. We've got a slight wind, so that's giving it some help. Wow, we're just 68.03 and it's gone into the silver medal position. Next up is Harting with his fifth round attempt. His best so far had put him into second position. Oh my word, look at that. Well, that looks as though his German teammates in the crowd can't quite understand what's going on. He's so close out in the field. A massive strike of his hand against that brace front leg in this fixed feet style of throwing. And again, it just quivers in the air. It comes down. Does it just go past? Oh, it does. It goes past. He could have taken the lead in this fifth round. Harting doesn't want to lose. Oh, and he has 68.27. He goes into first place. This discus competition is hot tonight. Now, he was leading just now. Hadabi comes into the circle for his fifth throw. What can he do? Well, he looks mean. Oh, and my word, he's just gone past it again. And he gets the red flag. I can't believe it. Let's have a look at that because we'll see the infringement. It must have been at the front of the circle. He comes round. He splits the circle. He goes past the halfway line. Left foot goes. And there you go, the heel. The heel touches the top of the rim. Oh, my word. And he can't believe it because that would have taken the lead back. I think this last round is going to be electrifying.
What a competition this is.
Oh, my word. I'm going to have a bad throat.
Well, Sally Pearson preparing for the final of the women's 100-meter hurdles. That's coming up. Let me just remind you, her 12.39 in the semi-final was, in fact, a United Kingdom all-comers record. No one has ever run faster in the United Kingdom. But just looking at the battle of that last 200 metres, Fraser Price just being overtaken in the final stages by the 400 metre gold medalist. There you've got it, Sanya Richards Ross, 22.30. Shelly-Ann Fraser Price, 22.34. You're right, what a final.
Magnificent track action, a magnificent field events as well. Those are the competitors who will make that final. A very high standard indeed. Hackett and Sumari joining the first twos.
And Kanter comes into the circle for his sixth and final throw. He's in the bronze medal position. This is the defending champion from Beijing. What can he do? He needs 68.27 to take the lead. Well, he's not screaming and shouting at this one. Oh, and well, it seals his fate tonight. He's got to wait. He has a wry grin. He's gone over 68 meters, just over 60, 68.03 in that last, that fifth round throw. And he knew that it wasn't quite as good as that fifth round throw. So Kanter, 66.99, what a great series. And what a great competition this has been. And now into the circle comes Malachowski from Poland, who is in fifth position with a 67-meter throw. This competition has been as the highest standard that you can imagine for a discus final. And he gets the red flag, so he won't be contesting the medals tonight. He'll silver in Beijing behind Kanter. So he finishes with 67.19 and finishes in fifth position tonight. Aleknas next up, and he's in fourth position. Not bad for a 40-year-old. So Alekna, what can he do in his last round? Can he threaten the medalists? He spins around the active reverse technique, and it's around 65 meters. He knows it's not good enough, so he'll deliberately foul that. So we move into, so that's a red flag for Alekna on his sixth throw. What a competition he's had. He almost walks out with disgust. And he's not going to win a medal tonight. 67.38, he's in fourth. He finishes in fourth position just outside the medals. He's gone gold, gold and bronze, and now he's gone fourth. So, into the circle comes Robert Harting of Germany. He's been unbeaten in 28 finals since August 2010. He was fourth in 2008. What can he do on his sixth round throw? Well, it's gone over 65, but it hasn't gone over what he did in that fifth round, 68-27. He will now have a very, very, very nervous wait, because Hadabi, who goes last because he led at the cut when, after three rounds, they reversed the order. But look at that series. He hasn't been below 67 meters, I don't think. So, can the Iranian handle the pressure? He had a big no throw, if you remember, earlier on in the competition in the fifth round. He followed Harting into the circle and he went past Harting, but he fouled the front of the circle. So, Harting's grimacing. I don't think he can watch this. Hadabi, last attempt to win the gold back. It's fast. Oh, and it's just over 65 meters. So Harting's off. He's off. I bet the vest to come off in a minute, because when he wins, he rips it off. He's like the Hulk. The only thing he doesn't do is he doesn't go green like the Hulk. And the Germans are gone crazy. What a fantastic discus competition. 68-27 in the fifth round, and here he goes. Just watch him pull it off. The Fedora, there it is. He is the Hulk all in person, really. What a fantastic, fantastic throw to take it in the fifth round. You've got to have courage and you've got to have skill. And he was the only fixed feet thrower in that final that was contesting. And here's the Iranian, Hadabi.
The first ever Iranian medal at the Olympics in athletics. So full marks to him. What a wonderful competition
well,
it was.
I'm just delighted to be able to call it tonight. I have enjoyed every minute, even right down to that vest coming off.
Well, now we go back to a wonderful run last night, too, on the track in the men's 400 meters. Well, these great events follow in rapid succession. This is a magnificent Olympic Games, no doubt about that. Now, Richard Peterkin of St. Lucia, member of the IOC, to make the presentations. And, of course, there's a very fitting man standing just behind him when it comes to 400 meter running. 800 meter running too when it comes to that, because Alberto Wantarena, council member of the IAAF, will also accompany the medal presentations.
The only man in history to win the 400-800 double, if I remember correctly.
Well, you were there, so was I, in Montreal in 1976.
Quite right.
So this man has made huge progress at these championships, not out inside 45 seconds before, but he ran twice, both in the semi-final and in the final. This is Lalonde Gordon. It's a change of the generations when it comes to 400 meter running. He's one of them. An all-Caribbean lineup for these medalists. Took fourth place with Chris Brown as well, come to that. And what a talent this man is. The world junior champion, now the Olympic silver medalist, Luguelin Santos, Dominican Republic, a relatively slight figure, but huge speed and endurance for the speed endurance for the 400 meters. But the winner won by a huge margin, some 5 or 6 meters clear of the rest of the field. And the winner is a huge talent, world youth champion, world junior champion, world senior champion. And we're just about to see the gold medal presented now to the man from Grenada, Kirani James. So for the first time, the Grenada national anthem rings out. The first gold medal in the Olympic Games for Grenada. Indeed, the first medal of any colour in athletics for Grenada. Previous best was also at this event. Alain Francique took a fourth place. And now in Kirani James, they have a man who's surely going to be at the forefront of 400 metre running for years to come.
Well, meanwhile, at the other end of the track to the discus, where all sorts of things were going off, with Harting winning the gold medal down there, we have Yukov and his gold medal performance in the high jump. He was the only man to go clear at 2 meters 38, thank you, Peter. In the excitement of just lost my, there we go, 2 meters 38, and the Kennard of America, US of A, 233, and then we've got three bronze medalists. I wonder how often that's happened at the Olympic Games. Perhaps it has happened before in the high jump. I'd have to check it out. All the way down to 14th, Michael Hanane of France at 2 metres 20. But the fight was on for the gold medal, and there was all sort of chessboard moves going on in terms of taking attempts here and moving on. But Yukov went clear at 2 metres 38. And Robert Harting, meanwhile, is slowly making his way around the track.
And Gerd Kattner, the champion in and a reigning Olympic gold medalist from Beijing, he takes the bronze. And I think the Germans will be celebrating tonight. And along with that is Hadabi from Iran, who got the silver medal. Desperately unlucky. Oh, my word, Harting. Don't do that, my boy. Your groin ago. Oh, look at this. Wow. Not bad for a big man. What do you think, Stuart, technically?
Yeah, lead leg's a bit sloppy.
It's heavy to get up. It's heavy. Wow.
Well, he's proving quite a competitor, isn't it? The way at competition after competition he comes through in the last couple of rounds or so to seize victory.
Peter, it was such a fantastic competition all through the rounds tonight.
Well, here we're coming up now to the final of the women's 100 metre hurdles, and what a final it should prove to be. We've already had a United Kingdom all-comers record in the hands of Sally Pearson of Australia, coming out of that semi-final 12.39. But finals are different, things can happen, and there is the lineup. In lane two, Lolo Jones of the United States. Three, Felicia George, Canada. Four, Dawn Harper, USA. Five, Kelly Wells, USA. Six, Nevin Yanit of Turkey. Seven, Sally Pearson of Australia. Eight, Jessica Zelinka of Canada. And nine, Beta Schrott of Austria. This should be a good race, this one. Now then, right on the inside, Lolo Jones, 12.71 in the semi-final, through as a fastest loser, twice world indoor champion. Seventh in the last Olympic final, where she was en route to winning it, hit a hurdle, went from first to seventh. So disappointing for her. This is Felicia George, a world finalist last year, set a personal best of 12.65 in the semi-final, through as a fastest qualifier. The defending champion, Dawn Harper of the United States, setting a personal best in the semi-final of 12.46. That's the time to do it. Kelly Wells of the United States can be erratic, can win. Season's best, 12.51 in the semi-final. Second to Dawn Harper in the US trials. Beat Sally Pearson in London recently. Nevin Yanit, twice European champion, the Balkan champion, set a national record in the semi-final of 12.58. The Olympic silver medalist from 4 years ago, the reigning world champion, indoors and out, the new holder of the UK all-comers record. Sally Pearson of Australia, 12.39 in the semi-final. Can she prevail here? Jessica Zelinka of Canada, a heptathlete. She was seventh in the heptathlon here. She beat all the Canadian top hurdlers in the Canadian trials. Deserves her place in this final. And Beta Schrott of Austria, the Austrian record holder, 12.83 in the semi-final, was fourth in the European Championships in Barcelona just before the Olympic Games. Jones, George, Harper, Wells, Yanit, Pearson, Zelinka, Schrott. The Olympic women's 100 metres hurdles final. Time and Pearson gets away very strongly indeed, and Wells going very well too, and so is Harper on the far side. But Sally Pearson is coming away from this, or is she? Harper's coming through very strongly. Well, Pearson gets it, I think, from Harper, and it's 12.35. It's a new Olympic record. It was so close. The Olympic champion from 2008 almost defended, and Pearson doesn't know. She doesn't know, but I think she got it. I really do. I think she got it. It was so close on the line. But that is going to be one of those close photograph decisions, but I think that Pearson got that, but it's very, very close. I have to say, between Pearson and Harper, yes, she did get it, I was right. Pearson is the Olympic champion, 12.35, and Harper must surely have broken her personal best, and Australia have got that much-needed gold medal. 12.35, 12.37 from Dawn Harper. How hard she tried to retain her Olympic title, but that was a sensational final, it really was. And where Pearson really was under pressure. She didn't know until the end, and she's embraced there by Kelly Wells. Now the celebration can begin. She's been dominant in the hurdles, but that is the closest, really, apart from the defeat to Kelly Wells in the London Diamond League meeting. But this is an Olympic final, this is different, and Dawn Harper did not want to lose her title that she set 4 years ago. But Sally Pearson, brilliant, the reigning world champion, she's now the Olympic champion. And it was, there's a coach, absolutely superb performance. The UK all-comers record once again for the second time, they both went through that barrier. And Kelly Wells at 12.48, a personal best for her. So Olympic record, personal best, season's best for Lolo Jones in fourth. And a national record for Yannet again at 12.58. What a final. And that was a superb race. And the look of relief on this young woman's face says it all. She didn't know. I thought she'd got it, and she had got it. It was close. Harper was closing down. Let's have another look at this. She gets the better start. She attacks the first hurdle brilliantly. Harper's down at the moment on Wells, but look at the second half of her race. Pearson's got the speed, the basic speed. She comes off the hurdle well. She's leading well here, but look at Harper come back at her on the far side. Look, it's so close, but she does get there just. Harper almost just a little stumble at the end, which lost it, but Pearson deserved it and got it. She was so determined, but Harper didn't have the best start. I have to say, Dawn Harper in the third in from the right of your top of your picture, but look at the way she closed it down. Pearson, basic speed told in the end. There it is, wonderful stuff, with Kelly Wells getting the bronze medal. That was a very, very, look, a very, very good race. Terrific final. New United Kingdom all-comers record, new Olympic record. Perhaps we should have said that first. And Australia have a gold medal. They've been few and far between in these Olympic Games, I can tell you, and that'll be much celebrated.
Certainly will. It's the fourth time in Australia has won the gold at this event too. It's been a spectacular event for them, going back to Shirley Strickland, and of course in the days when it was an 80 metre hurdles race as well. So, and then Maureen Caird also winning a gold medal. Strickland twice and Caird when it was 80 metre hurdles, and now Pearson for Australia. But what a, once again, in London 2012, sprint finals, tremendous depth of times as well. First seven broke 12.7.
Yep, indeed. Remember, this came, moved from 80 metre hurdles, if you mention it now, to 100 metre hurdles in Munich in 1972. Annelie Earhart of East Germany won that one. But in 1988, Jordanka Donkova won and broke the world record. Here it is. The result of the 100-metre hurdles final. Sally Pearson is the Olympic champion, a new Olympic record, 12.35. Dawn Harper, the defending champion, gets the silver this time, 12.37. And Kelly Wells gets the bronze in 12.48.
Well, it was raining, still raining, but it hasn't dampened the enthusiasm of the hurdlers one jot.
No, indeed. Joanne Hayes won the title in 2004. And Dawn Harper, as we've said, with a silver medal this time, won the title in 2008. So that was a very, very fine. And remember last year, or 4 years ago, Dawn Harper almost didn't get into the US team. She only qualified by a hundredth of a second to get in the team and came to the Olympic Games in Beijing and won the title. Another look at it, it's well worth it because it was a superb final. Sally Pearson really, over the season as a whole, has been winning races by a big margin. And it must, she must have taken a knock when she was beaten by Kelly Wells in the Diamond League meeting in London. And since that time, that must have played on her mind. But here, whilst most of the race, Kelly Wells was the one pressuring, then all of a sudden, the defending Olympic champion came through and looked very, very much as though she might close Pearson down, but she didn't. And that's all that matters. She didn't.
And Harper really dived for the line there. But Sally Pearson is such a tough competitor.
Yep.
Above all, you have to say that now. She really is determined and has that toughness of mind. So, yes, she lost the previous race. I don't think that would have worried her too much.
She didn't know at this stage, and nope. She looked across. Have I done it? Yeah, that was the moment of realization. Yep, it's yours. You've done it. It was hard. It wasn't easy. For someone who's been so dominant in the event over the last season, the last two seasons, really, she only faltered in Brussels last year at the last race when she fell down. She won everything last season, and she's won pretty well everything except one race this season. She truly deserves this. She's a lovely girl and goes down into the history books to follow. I began to say Yordanka Donkova of Bulgaria, who holds the world record. But Harper, she tried, she gritted her teeth, she went so hard for that. Brilliant, good race. Olympic champions don't give up very easily, they don't, and Dawn Harper proved it. And Kelly Wells, well, she was terrific all the way. Look how the rain is pouring down, no one noticed. And that was a poor trail leg off that hurdle by Wells, and that may well have lost her a little bit of ground. She lost a bit of momentum coming off it. But she's pleased that she's got a medal. But those times are incredibly quick. They really are. Very, very quick indeed. 12:35. The world record, well, 12:21. And I think that Pearson is capable of that. But Dawn Harper celebrating as well she might. It was a truly magnificent Olympic hurdles final. It lived up to its billing. And just looking back at Harting, who destroyed the field in the end in the discus. He wouldn't give up, would he?
Well, you say destroyed it, but it was an incredibly close contest throughout the night. And there, that's the first time we've seen the final scoreboard. Harting wins the gold medal with 68-27. He was the highest ranked German athlete in Beijing. They didn't win anything else. And second goes to Adadi with that 68-18. And then Gerd Kanter had a season's best to throw 68-03. So all three over 68 metres. What a fantastic competition that was.
Well, we've had a lot of excitement here tonight. And I'm sure that's going to continue as Nick Willis leads out the athletes in the men's 1500 metre final. Willis, the silver medalist. Kiprop, the gold medalist, top and tail this field in the 1500 metres. Well, the 1500 metres has always been one of the great events in Olympic athletics. Just looking through the previous champions, some of the great names, Jack Lovelock, Herb Elliott, Peter Snell, Kip Kino, John Walker, Seb Coe, of course, who won twice, and Kiprop's hoping to emulate him. Morsley, Elgaru, some of the really great athletes of all time have had their names on that list. But let's just take a check back of something earlier in this evening. We obviously didn't concentrate so much on it because it's a qualifying round. Proctor, Deloach, May Mellis and Sokolova were the four who achieved the automatic qualifying standard. Brittany Rees seemed to have a jump near 7 metres, but in fact she obviously touched back earlier. Nonetheless, she did get through despite a pretty modest jump of 6 metres 57. Top 12 going through to the women's long jump final.
Just to confirm that actually the 12th position in that long jump qualifying group, A and B, was actually 6 metres 40, Shtkova of Belarus.
The 1500 metres for men closes this fifth day of action here in the Olympic Stadium in London. There's an interesting story about this man, Tevfik Makhloufi. He was a very impressive semi-final winner. He then took to the track in the 800 metres and stepped off it about halfway around the first lap. That caused a disqualification on the grounds of not giving true effort, but that was appealed against, and in fact he was allowed to continue in the games because he would otherwise have been disqualified for the 1500 on medical evidence of having a migraine.
I see.
Well, he shouldn't have been entered in the 1500 meters. One can only assume it's a team effort, because it was halfway between the 800 meters semi-final and the 1500 final. So now he can concentrate on that. El Garouge, the world record holder, Noah Nguyen, who beat El Garouge to win the title in Sydney, holds the Olympic record at 2:32.07. That's within the compass of several of these men, but of course it depends how the race is run. That's important. Let's just run through the starters then. Nick Willis of New Zealand, Matt Centrovitz of the USA, Nixon Chipsaber of Kenya, Abdelati Eguida of Morocco, Mekonnen Gebremedyen of Ethiopia, Silas Kiplagat of Kenya, Ilham Özbilen of Turkey, Lionel Manzano of USA, Belal Mansour Ali of Bahrain, Henrik Ingebrigtsen of Norway, Tariq Makhloufi of Algeria, and Aspel Kiprop of Kenya. Well, he's the defending champion. Of course, he got that after Rashid Ramzi was disqualified for drugs abuse, having crossed the line first in the Beijing Olympics. Kiprop eventually awarded the gold medal for that event. 1500 meters, always one of the most keenly anticipated athletics finals. Looking at Aguida there on our right, world indoor champion. Next to him, Gebremedyen, who was third in that race in Istanbul, indoors. Ali in the center of affairs there, the athlete from the Bahrain. He was a finalist in 2008, as of course were the gold and silver medalists, Kiprop and Willis, and Aguida was fifth in that race. Ingebrigtsen of Norway, up-and-coming young talent, took the European title. He's just on the right there in the red and blue strip. There is the back view of Makhloufi, who ran away with both heat and semi-final, and he's run 3:30.80 this year. Must have a real chance. So let's just go through the lineup then, from the outside in. Here is Aspel Kiprop, world champion, defending champion, but reportedly with an injury concern. Taoufik Makhloufi of Algeria, semi-final winner. Slow time that race, but he's quick in 3:30. Then the European champion, Henrik Ingebrigtsen. It's a slowly run race. He can produce a fine finish. Belal Mansour Ali of Bahrain, a 3:31 man. Finalist in Beijing, comes back again. Kenyan born. Here's another man who's one of the best finishers, Lionel Manzano, the American champion. Small figure, very sharp finisher. Another Kenyan born man who switched allegiance, this time to Turkey. It's the world indoor silver medalist, Ilham Tanui Özbilen, formerly William Tanui. Silas Kiplagat is the Commonwealth champion. He's the world silver medalist. And if there's any problem with Kiprop, maybe he's the favorite. A sub 3:30 man. Mekonnen Gebremedyen, seventh in the world championships last year, third in the world indoors. Represents the hope of Ethiopia. Their one runner in this final. Abdelati Eguida of Morocco, fifth in Beijing, world indoor champion, twice a world championship finalist. 3:31.47 is his best. Then another Kenyan who's dipped under 3:30 this year to make him the third fastest in the world this year. Nixon Chipsada, winner in Hengelo, second in Monaco in the Diamond League race. Then next to him, the man who was a surprise bronze medalist in the World Championships last year, another very fast finisher, Matt Centrovitz of the USA. His father was a top athlete. And now he's following in the family tradition. And Nick Willis looks in terrific form. Recently smashed the Oceania record when he was second, in the third rather, in the Monaco Diamond League meeting. Second last time. And he looks in very good form indeed to challenge the Kenyans and the North Africans. The final, the men's 1500 meters. Well, what sort of race will we have? Will it be a fast one? Will it be a slow tactical race? Who's going to go to the front? Well, at the moment, it's McLoofy who's taken up that running, but he's been passed on either side of him at the moment, and they are going at a pretty useful pace just at the moment in this early stage of the race. The Kenyans hungry back at the moment.
It's Aguida who's taking it on at the front of this group. He's slowing it down a little bit at the moment now with McLoofy. Ali's coming out on the outside. Willis is trapped right on the inside. And Chepchaber, and you can see Kiprop there, the tall figure of the defending champion as they approach 400 metres with three laps to go.
So not particularly quick. They spent it off just to make sure they got in the right sort of position. We're going to be around 60 seconds, I think, for the first lap here. That's the first of the Kenyans. On the outside there is Chepsaber. Chepsaber just coming into the lead. Well, 58:30, it's a reasonable pace. And Ali of Bahrain it is, Chepsaber of Kenya. Kiplagat, you can just see the next Kenyan. He's back in sixth place at the moment. Neguida also is prominent. Centrovitz, the American, quite prominent there, and third place on the inside of Aguida. Willis just behind them. So it's Ali and Chepsaber at the head of the field in the 1500 metres. Steady pace rather than especially quick. So the whole field very much together. Chepsaber running on the outside, then Centrovitz, then Aguida, Nick Willis in the All Black of New Zealand. McLoofy is in sixth place. Then the two Kenyans just behind, the taller figure of Kiprop, fourth from the back at the moment.
Well, the third lap, very, very important, of course, in 1500 metre running, and this is where the race will start to be decided. And now McLoofy is moving behind Willis. Willis was trapped in on the inside for a good bit of this race. He's now moved. Well, he's still on the inside, and he's got to find a way out with just a lap and a half to go in this final. Ali's still leading, certainly.
Centrovitz moving up on the outside of Chepsaber at the moment. Well, Ali's just been passed at the moment by the Kenyans. And then Gebremedium also moving up now. They're all jockeying for positions. McLoofy still looking strong. Centrovitz running a really positive race. The American, who's on the outside of Chepsaber. Kiplagat coming off on the outside. So it is Chepsaber as they come up towards the bell with Willis behind. Kiprop, I'm afraid, doesn't look as if he's going to be out of it. He's second from the back. So let's concentrate on the front. It's Chepsaber. And now McLoofy coming up on the shoulder of Chepsaber with Kiplagat running wide on the outside. Willis is holding on to that inside lane position. Centrovitz still well placed. Here comes Gebremedian of Ethiopia as well. Kiprop, I'm afraid, that injury has put pay to his chances. It was a 56-second lap there to 1,200 metres. And McLoofy making his way home, followed by Chepsaber, followed by Gebremedian, this long-striding Ethiopian. And Aguida getting back into it. But McLoofy, who looked so impressive in the early rounds, nearly got disqualified, but he's running away with this, is the Algerian. It's McLoofy who's heading for home, and he's opened up a really big lead. Gebremedian has now moved into second place, but it's McLoofy really well clear of this field. Manzano finishing like a train as well, the two Americans. But it's McLoofy who's taken this gold medal here. And the small figure of Manzano coming through. Well, what an interesting race. 3:34.08 for McLoofy. Well, he wouldn't have been given much of a chance coming into this race. But as it was, he ran clear of the field in each of the races there. And Aguida also finishing strongly to take third place. But it's all about McLoofy, and what a story this is of how he ran in the 800 and was disqualified. They appealed and he got back into it again. You would have had long odds on him winning beforehand. What a finish this man always produces. Manzano as he came into second place, and Aguida just behind him, and Centrovitz running another strong race, the two Americans coming second and fourth. But unfortunately there, of course, Kiprop really wasn't obviously in condition to challenge, and surprisingly Kiplagat, the top Kenyan, only seventh, and Chepsaber fading as well.
Yeah, it was a strange one, wasn't it, in the end? But this fella, McLoofy, big improvement this year from 146.32 to 143.88 at 800 metres, and down from 3:32.94 to 3:30 at 1500 metres. So his basic speed is up, so his speed endurance is there. He proved that. His strength endurance is there, and he's come away as the Olympic champion. And well, the Kenyans will find themselves, well, they'll go back to the drawing board. Kiprop, a smile, but he was injured, and we knew that.
And we knew that he'd got to the final, and that, in a way, was credit to him, but he was never competitive in that final. He really wasn't. A good run by Manzano, the American. He got a season's best in 3:34.79. And Degida of Morocco coming through very quickly in 3:35.13, just holding off Centrovic.
But he opened up such a big lead, didn't he, along that back straight, and he held it. He was so much the strongest. Gebre Meriem challenging there, but he was to fade quite badly. Now, just look how far back both Egida and Manzano are as they put in the term in sprints down the finishing straight. There's Manzano and, there's Egida rather ahead at the moment. Manzano passing him, and Centrovic also. So the red vest there, first of all the Moroccan, and then the American, then the Moroccan, then the other American.
Yeah, Luffy was very lucky to be in the final, I have to say, to get a credit for migraine when he stopped in the 800 metres. It was clear that he didn't need to run the 800 metres, and it would have affected his performance in the 1500. But you can only take the result of the medical commission and allowing him through to the final. It was somewhat controversial around the stadium, I have to say that, because the rules do state that you have to run to the best of your ability in a race, and he just went round the first bend and stopped, and but managed to get himself into the final, and he's come away with a gold medal.
But he certainly ran dominant races in both heat and semi-final, so an Algerian win here in the 1500 metres, and that's certainly pretty much of a surprise. And we've seen a whole series of runners, of course, come from North Africa to run really well at 1500 meter races, and not least in this event, two women's champions, Boumerka and Mera Baneda, and of course he follows in the footsteps of Nouredine Morsali. So gold medal going to Tewfik Makhloufi of Algeria, the silver to Lionel Manzano of USA, and the bronze to Abdelati Egida of Morocco. Behind Makhloufi, there was a whole series of runs by fast finishers, but look at that, Kiplagat 7th, Willis 9th, and Kiprop 12th, and I think those have been the choices of many people as the three most likely medalists coming into this event. But as we've said before, Kiprop had an injury, he ran very bravely to even get through to the final. So yet another very fascinating evening here in the Olympic Stadium, and we've had some great races, we've had terrific action in the field events as well, ending with the 1500 metres.
As this celebration of the 1500 metres goes ahead, it's been another really good night in the Olympic Stadium. It began with the high jump and Ivan Yukov of Russia clearing 2 meters and 38 and comprehensively winning the high jump competition, and then a very entertaining discus with Robert Harting and of Germany. Sally Pearson won the hurdles and Makhloufi won the 1500 meters. Well, from the, we'll just look again in the final stages of that, as I say, from Peter Matthews and my colleagues here in the commentary box. Goodbye.
The beautiful and graceful sport of synchronized swimming debuted at the 1984 Los Angeles Olympics with the women's duet. The dynamic team event was added at the 2000 Olympic Games in Sydney. The synchronized swimming event takes place at the same pool as the swimming competition.